The fighting and the contentious behaviors and such will become very boring to you, very boring, and old news, and a waste of time, and people will start coming together collectively and realizing how very powerful you can be when you come together and find unity in your diversity, rather than seeing it as, oh, I've got to change everybody to comply and be like me. You can just dance together. You can enjoy the dance, the journey to the heart together, and find that everybody has something to contribute. And there will be a lot more, if you will, eventually. It's not going to happen right away, but you will start to see inklings of it in this year and in the next 3-4 years of human beings who are going to start saying, you know, something, we really do need to listen to each other. We need each other.
I'd like to welcome to the show Summer Bacon. How are you doing, Summer?
I'm doing great. Thank you, Alex. Thanks for having me here. I'm excited.
Oh, thank you so much for coming on the show. I'm very excited to talk to you and the entity that you channel, Dr. Peebles, who I've heard many good things about. So I would love to, I'm looking forward to that. But before we get into our channeling session with Dr. Peebles, I'd like to ask you, my first question is, what was your life like before this insanity that is channeling came into your world?
Yeah, it was more insanity. it was channeling made sense of my life. Basically, when I was 11 months old when I realized I was here to do spiritual work, and when I realized that I was here to find out what this truth thing is about once and for all, and then as I was growing up, I saw spirits, heard spirits, felt spirits. I mean, everything. It was just nonstop. It was constant. And I'd heard about, you know, God is love and God is this and God is that, but I really wanted to know, you know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that there is life after death, and that that God is real, and that his love is constant, and that if God really loves me, then he's got my back. And that set me off on my journey with as a trance medium eventually. I didn't do it until the trance medium that I met Dr. Peebles through was Thomas Jacobson. And when he quit channeling, I thought, oh my gosh, I need to keep that connection with Dr. Peebles. And so I started seeking him with my heart, and then I eventually, you know, became a trance medium. There's a whole lot more to that story, but sure. From you know, from what you're asking me, my life before channeling, you know, I mean, it was pretty awesome. I had great parents. We performed a lot of music. I went to college. I went to UCLA. I worked at Goods and Todman Productions on game shows, on Super Password and Family Feud and things like that. You know, a lot of real kind of fun, normal stuff in a way. And, but this other part of me was just constantly haunting me. This other part of me was just, why am I seeing spirits? Why am I hearing them? Why am I, you know, I was so psychic and I didn't know why. And it kind of drove me nuts, quite
frankly.
Well,
were you like Sixth Sense? Were you seeing dead people?
I was seeing dead people. Oh yeah. Yeah. And one of the very first ones that I saw was my grandfather. I never did drugs. I wasn't, you know, so I couldn't attribute it to that. I was 17 years old and I woke up in the middle of the night, and I looked up and there was this man standing there at the side of my bed, all encased, enclosed, I would say, in bright white light. And I knew it was my grandfather immediately. And he said to me telepathically, he said, do you have a question? And I said, yes. I said, does it hurt to die? And his answer was, so much love that poured out of him, and that was, you know, no, it doesn't hurt to die, but it was a feeling of, no, you're completely and utterly safe. All my fears of death disappeared at that moment. It was absolutely extraordinary. And the love that I felt was so incredible. That helped me tremendously in my journey, because at least I wasn't afraid of death anymore, never have been since then. And so I also, you know, had a lot of experiences, such as out of body experiences when I was 17 again. Thank God I had the parents I had, because they didn't tell me I was crazy. And they, in fact, almost encouraged me to explore it. My dad, especially. And, yeah, so that was pretty incredible. But my first out of body experience terrified me.
Mm-hmm.
I just came home from school and laid down on my bed. I was exhausted, and I suddenly found myself hovering over my body, and I looked down and I was like, what the heck, you know, and I made a beeline back for my body at that moment. And, but they didn't stop. Those things did not stop. And so it's been, you know, a lot. It was a lot for me growing up.
Yeah. How did you psychologically deal with this stuff? Because I mean, luckily you had a family that was supportive about this.
I had a family that was very supportive. Yeah.
So that's a blessing that you had, because a lot of channels go through the same thing you did and did not have a supportive family. So at least you had a supportive family, but psychologically, this must've been, you know, you had to deal with, I mean, look, when you're 11, first of all, you're 11 months old and you're starting to figure things out. That's interesting enough. But as a child, you don't even have the hardware, the programming yet to deal with much of life at that point. Yeah. You're still developing. But then this being thrown on you, seeing dead people, it just throws your entire reality out of whack. So how did you deal with it?
But you know what? It's interesting because it didn't throw my reality out of whack. That was my reality.
Right. So that was just,
it was hard to feel like I fit into the world because nobody understood me, but that was my reality. So it wasn't like it threw my reality out of whack. I just needed to know why I was seeing these things and hearing these things and feeling these things and other people didn't. Like one night I was with my best friend, and I think I was 12 years old and she was 13, and we had a sleepover, and I said something like, I said, isn't it so cool how you can see air? She goes, see air? And I'm like, yeah. And I thought, everybody saw air. I see air, but that's what now I know is energy. I mean, air doesn't, it has substance to me. I can see it, I can move it, I can touch it, you know, and that's also where, that's the space in which spirit will manifest in that space. What we think is empty is not. It's quite full and quite active. So those were kind of the awkward moments in my life when I would say things to people and they'd look at me like I was wacky, you know, but I don't know. I never apologized for it. I never tried to hide away from it, except I will tell you this. I was working at our family's recording studio and I was out of my first marriage, which was extremely violent. And I was suicidal. I'll be quite frank. I was ready to just die. I just didn't want to do this anymore. And we had no business at the studio. It was pretty dead. And I thought, I'm going to kill myself. And then I thought, but I'm going to go get the mail first. I mean, go figure, right?
Jesus.
So I go out to go get the mail and I'm walking across the parking lot and it's a cool spring day. And I step into this pocket of warmth. I mean, unbelievable warmth. And these hands come down over me. The giant hands came down over me. And I'll tell you this, this is not part of my upbringing. I didn't go to church. You know, we weren't like, you know, all Christian family or anything like that. I didn't have that upbringing, but it was definitely Jesus. I mean, I knew it. And I heard the words, I love you, Summer. And I stepped, the next step was out of that warmth. And I was like, what? And I stepped back into it and it was there again. And then I was like, wow, that was awesome. And I went to the mail, got the mail, and I wasn't going to commit suicide anymore. Well, then my born again Christian friends started telling me, oh, you're born again. You've met Jesus and all this stuff. So I thought, okay, well, maybe this is how I get rid of these experiences of seeing and hearing, feeling spirit, because they were trying to convince me that it was all about demons and,
obviously,
you know, you're seeing demons and da, 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 da. Well, so I started going to church and these experiences that I had just intensified, got even worse. I mean, but not bad experiences, all very loving, you know, all very beautiful, like with my grandfather. So one day I went to church and it was a big evangelical church, and the minister said he wanted us to break into groups of like 10 people, you know, in a circle. And I had noticed before the service started that there's this very old gentleman came in, the last person to come in to the church, all hunched over, could barely stand up to walk. It had to be like 90 something, you know. And he was all hunched over and he sat in the back pew. And I thought, oh, the poor man, you know, my heart went out to him. And I just thought, what a beautiful thing, you know, there he is in church and he made it. So we're in these circles of 10 and the minister is encouraging us to call on the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit might move you, you know, and you just let the Holy Spirit move you, and words might come out of your mouth that you don't understand. So you just go ahead and do that, you know, just allow for it. Okay. So, I mean, I was super naive. I go, okay. And apparently this went on with me for 20 minutes. When I finally opened my eyes and was aware, you know, came back from what happened, I had been apparently speaking in tongues for like 20 minutes. And I opened my eyes and I looked around this church, and I'm telling you, there were like 300 people in this church. It was, you could hear a pin drop. And they backed away from me. They literally took steps back away from me.
Like in a movie.
It was unbelievable. And then this old man in the back pew, he stands up, unfolds, like completely unfolds, puts his arms up, his head back, and this angelic voice came out of him that was unbelievable. It was so beautiful. And I'm thinking, wow, we're here in the midst of a miracle. I'm watching this happen, and I'm like, wow. And the minister just kind of looks around nervously, flips through his Bible, you know, and takes out his hymn book. He goes, let's go to him, blah, blah, blah. And that was it. And I'm thinking, wait, excuse me? You didn't see that? You didn't acknowledge that? This is the stuff you're talking about, is the miracles, you know, that can happen in life. And then that old man just kind of curled up again and sat back down all hunched over. Well, I was on my way home that day, and I said, God, I can't do this. I said, I can't go back to church. And I said, if I'm going to burn in hell, then I'll burn in hell, you know. And I hear, Summer, if you go to hell, he said, I hear this voice say, Summer, if you go to hell, I'm there too with you. He said, there's always a chance for your redemption or something like that. And I thought, wow, that makes a lot of sense. God is omniscient. God is omnipresent. God is everywhere. God is everything. And this is what set me off on a whole different path with my understanding of spirit. And I can tell you that my parents and my friends were so happy that I got out of the church, because I was seeing Satan in my lunch meat. You know, I mean, it was like they talked more about Satan and the devil than they talked about Jesus or love or God or anything.
It was all fear-based.
Oh, just incredible. Yeah. Yeah. And God bless these people. They're great. You know, they're doing their best to understand, but you know, I mean, I heard you on one of your podcasts say something like you're a recovering Catholic or something.
Yes, I am a recovering Catholic. Yes, yes. Recovering Catholic.
Yeah. Well, but you know, the beauty of that, Alex, is that I've had a lot of clients who, you know, with what I do, it might surprise you, but a lot of them are Catholics. Them, believe it or not, Mormon and things like that. But the thing is, when somebody's raised in the Catholic Church, they pretty much have half the battle won, because they're taught to believe in angels and spirits. So you're already like halfway there to understanding the bigger, broader picture of the universe and how energy works and light and love and all of that. So it really is in some ways, a really great foundation for people to really grow. Because some people are born with no awareness, no belief system of anything beyond, you know, their house and car.
You're very right on that, because when I was, you know, going through Catholic school, and I just realized early on, I'm like, this doesn't make any sense. I mean, I remember in elementary school, I'm like, it doesn't make sense for me. So I never really bought into it. I was there. I had to kind of go through the motions, but the thing that did stick was the concept of love, the concept of a higher power. You know, I was told about hell when I was in first grade. Can you imagine terrifying a child about hell? You know, this concept, this ridiculous concept that's hell and Satan and the devils and all this kind of stuff. It's just, it didn't make any sense. So I kind of rejected all the fear-based stuff, but I kind of embraced the other stuff unconsciously, by the way. Nobody was guiding me in this. Nobody was guiding me in this. So, you know, here on Earth, nobody was guiding me. Nobody on Earth was guiding me in this dimension, at least. But no, there was, you know, but I always knew that. But you are absolutely right. People who have a Catholic or Mormon or a little bit more militant aspect of the Christian faith is going to be open to a lot of things, as opposed to some of the sects that are much more fear-based, like you were talking about, like completely 100% fear-based. Don't get me wrong, I still feel guilty about my Catholic upbringing because guilt is a huge thing. I'm joking about the guilt, but I don't feel guilty. But generally speaking, there's like, oh my God, if you don't do this, this will happen. So there's this pressure on you all the time. But you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
Great philosopher Alan Watts said that, that the Catholic Church made guilt a virtue.
absolutely, without question. So yeah. Let me ask you, when you first started to channel, let's go into Dr. Peebles. So when you started to channel Dr. Peebles, can you explain what your process is and what kind of channel you are? Because there are multiple kinds of channels out there.
Well, I'm a trance medium. I go into a very deep trance, and Dr. Peebles comes through and uses actually my vocal cords, my body, to speak. Mm-hmm. I'm self-taught, not because I ever wanted to become a trance medium. I want to make that clear. I did it. I wanted to know that God was real. God's love was real and constant. And so I did, I sat down for, I don't know how many years I did this, but I would come home from work. I would sit in a dark room in the house and I would look at the center of the room. And I went on the understanding that, okay, if spirit is real and God is real, then they know I exist. So that's not that I don't have to worry about that part. They know I'm here. And if so, it's up to me to reach out to find them. And so I asked Dr. Peebles to come into the center of the room. And I was staring into the darkness at the center of the room. Not kidding you, I would do this sometimes for up to 4 hours to look for him. And I would try to open my heart and really look for him in the ethers, kind of just to try to see him. And this went on for, I don't know how long, years. And one night I was sitting there, I thought, I can't do this anymore. I'm kind of seeing something, but not really. And all of a sudden this big magenta orb just popped into the center of the room, and I'm looking at it and I was like, wow, that is so cool. So I started talking to the orb, and I would get yes answers to questions, and the orb would get big, and then no answers, the orb would get small. And eventually that orb flew over next to me. And I remember I reached up and tried to touch it, and my hand disappeared. And then eventually I invited Dr. Peebles to come in and to use my body. And I trusted in God. I just said to God, I said, I need to know that your love is real and constant. And if you got my back, then you got my back. If this is my destiny, or this is what I'm supposed to be doing, I know I'm safe in it. You know, and I released any fear of anything. Because there's a lot of fear around it, I can tell you. A lot mm-hmm. of people have fear around it. And so, you know, it was years of that kind of constant work to make that connection. Even though I was already so connected, you mm-hmm. know, as a little girl and everything else, it took years. And I can tell you one other little story of my first understanding about Dr. Peebles working with me. I went to bed one night. And when I woke up, my body was sitting up, but I hadn't done it. And my eyes were open, but I hadn't done it. I could feel that. I was out of body. And I was like, and I could hear somebody talking, saying, God bless you, God bless you, God, through my body. But I wasn't doing it. And I was like, wait, if I'm not in my body, who is? And I thought, am I in my body? And I, for the weird response I had to that was I flew over to the bathroom mirror. I saw my ethereal body in the mirror, and I was like, whoa, oh no, you know, and went back to my body and came back in. And as I came in, this other, I merged with this incredibly benevolent being who then left my body. And I was sitting there, sitting up in my bed going, what the heck just happened? And I heard two voices, angelic voices, like nothing that is human, at the side of my bed. And one of them said, well, it was a male voice. He said, well, what do you think? And the female voice said, well, it looks like destiny to me. And I was like, destiny? What destiny? You know? And that's what started me off on my adventure to see if I could connect with spirit. And eventually I did. It's a longer story than that, but that's basically it in a nutshell.
So when you decided to start channeling professionally, let's say, and you came out of the quote unquote channeling closet, mm-hmm. how the people around you, friends, families, colleagues, deal with it? And how did you deal with them dealing with it?
Well, you know, I didn't do it professionally for the first 6 years. I think it was 4 to 6 years. I channeled for anybody and everybody at the drop of a hat. If they needed help, I would channel. I started out by channeling dearly departed loved ones. It was full body channeling where spirits would come through with, you know, attributes that they had in life. There was one lady, she would constantly fiddle with her necklace because she used to do that all the time, you know, when she was alive. And I don't wear jewelry. So it was very interesting. But the people around me, you know, I was in Sedona, Arizona when I started channeling. So that was very helpful. Sedona's a very open-minded place. It's kind of in a bubble, you know, and especially back then, 29 years ago, people were actually quite encouraging of me doing the work, and they weren't afraid of it. But one thing was kind of funny. My mom and dad were a little like, is she okay? Is this, you know, sometimes people think it's schizophrenia, you know, that because mm-hmm. you're in full body trance, it's a whole different personality, whole different being coming through. So my mom actually had my godmother call me and say, "Hey, I want a session with you." And my godmother was a psychiatrist, psychologist. And so she was kind of testing the waters, and I didn't know they you know, were in cahoots on this. So I had a session. I did a session for my godmother, and she asked for her uncle to come through. She wanted to speak to her uncle, who I had never met, knew nothing about. Now, my godmother is this beautiful, wonderful woman who is very rather upper class, and very, you know, just very a Jewish mama,
proper,
you know,
proper.
Yeah, and Jewish mama, and she's just a wonderful woman, and she asks for her uncle. Well, her uncle comes through with this like Tennessee accent, really rough around the edges. And he's talking to her, and I'm thinking, you know, I'm in trance and I'm kind of like a puppet in those days with the dearly departed loved ones coming through. And and I can hear what's going on. And I'm thinking, this doesn't make sense to me at all. Well, she had a fabulous conversation with her uncle. It was her uncle, and he lived in Tennessee, and he had a Tennessee twang, and he was rough around the edges. And that was her test, you know, of me, to see if that uncle would actually come through, or would it be something I conjured up, knowing who she is and what I would imagine mm-hmm. her uncle to be like, you know? Mm-hmm. So that was the only one that I really remember. I had a couple of friends fall away, you know, they thought it was weird, but they, you know, we'd kind of lost touch anyway. And I, you know, frankly, I just never really, I just have never really cared so much about what people think. Mm-hmm. It's a strange thing. I don't like being attacked, you know, nobody does, but you know, for what I do, but I never really gave it that much, you know, thought about, well, if they don't like it, then they don't, you know, I can't change their mind for them. And I can only do what I know is real. It's so, you know, I know the truth of what I do. I don't do this to prove anything to anybody. Right. I do this as a demonstration of what is possible for anybody to do in terms of developing a deep, lasting relationship with God and spirit. You got to do the work. It's just like, you know, if we're going to be friends, we've got to call each other and have lunch, you know? And if you're not, it's not like spirit comes and pounces on you. Suddenly just one day I'm sitting here and all of a sudden Dr. Peebles just pounced on me. That would be really rude, frankly. And it would really rob me of the opportunity. For my personal growth, you know,
Right.
To learn how to reach out into the ethers and raise my vibration.
Well, let me ask you this question. What do you think this life is doing for your evolution as a soul? Because this is a very unique path to walk, and you're very connected with the other side. You're very connected with spirit. You're very connected with the love energy of God. Why do you think you have chosen to go through this life doing this work? Because it's not an easy path right now. It's easier now than it was 50 years ago, but it's still not an easy path.
You know, I know that I've been working through a lot of karma in this lifetime. I know that I've been persecuted in past lives and trying to get over that sort of fear. And really, it's to me about owning the God light within and really just trusting and believing in that, and not it's taught me so much about love, about loving all people, no matter who they are, what kind of attitude they have about life or anything, I've learned that we're all necessary, all of us. We need the contrasts, we need the light, we need the dark, we need it all in order to grow. So for me, I think it's just been a stripping down of a lot of fears, frankly, because in order to do the work, you really have to face a lot of fears, because a lot of things come in blocks and barriers inside of yourself. One time I channeled for a friend of mine who he asked for his friend Tino to come through. And Tino had, unbeknownst to me, been, he was executed on death row. He was on death row. And he had been a very, I guess, famous dancer who, in a rage one night — he was normally a very sweet, gentle soul — but in a rage one night, stabbed somebody in the back and killed them. So if I had known — I was 34 years old then, that was way back in when I first started channeling — and I would not have let him through, because I would have been judgmental. I would have thought, there's no way I'm giving this guy a voice. You know, he killed somebody, and I would have just been so judgmental about it. But when I let him through and I felt the truth of his spirit and the beauty of who he truly was, because he was not that one incident. You know, and that's what we end up doing a lot of times, is we pin something on somebody and that's it for life, and without looking at who they really are and their mm-hmm. the deep inner soul. And what I got to know from that experience was what a beautiful spirit he was. I felt his remorse. I felt his self-awareness that what he learned from that experience and from dying on death row. And he and my friend had a beautiful conversation. When I came out of that, I was a completely different person. I was a completely changed person. I suddenly mm-hmm. realized how judgmental I had been about people, not giving them, you know, even a minute to explain who they really are, or to really try to find out who they really are. And by channeling so many different dearly departed loved ones, it was a real eye opener to me. And it helped me to accept people as they are. We're all just growing. We're all doing our best. And you know, we're doing it in different, wide variety of ways. And so I really tried, you know, I've really tried all my life now to really just listen to people and not argue with people. And again, not to try to even prove myself to them. I don't care. You don't believe in what I do. I always tell my audiences, you know, if you don't, you know, if you leave here more skeptical than when you arrived, then you know more about who you are. And as far as I'm concerned, that's fine. There's nothing wrong living life as a skeptic. You sometimes need to do that in order to learn that there's even more, because the learning never ends.
When you channel, where do you go? Do you remember everything that's happening? Are you just kind of like sitting in a chair next to it? Do you go somewhere else and not remember it?
Yeah, it depends. It depends sometimes even on the, you know, who I'm channeling for and how mm-hmm. receptive they are. If they're really receptive, I really go, I can go off and not even remember anything about the session. Mm-hmm. As I've had sessions with people who are, you know, skeptical, and there's a tug and pull. And Dr. Peebles mm-hmm. would be like, you know, he would probably be like, hey, that's fine. You don't want to talk? That's great. I'll go. And I'm like, no, you have to finish the session, you know. But no, where do I go? I kind of feel like I go up and back. Mm-hmm. I kind of go up and I'm doing a swirly hand, but it's because I feel like I kind of turn around. And a lot of times when I come back out of trance, I'm like, why am I looking this way? Because I, you know, in trance, I feel like I'm looking another direction. Mm-hmm. And it's a very intense process. Because I say, he comes through and he takes over my vocal cords. He has a very different voice than I do. You know, I can feel him here. Even when I'm talking, I can feel the tugging of the muscles and stuff, like, cause they are here. Then, you know, he works with a band of angels. He's a spokesperson for a band of angels, and, quite a remarkable being. Dr. Peebles walked the earth, and, he died in 1922, at the age of 99.9 years old. He was just short of his 100th birthday. And he was a writer. He was a medical doctor, a naturopath. He traveled the world 5 times. He was a U.S. consulate to Turkey. He hobnobbed with the who's who of
the day.
The day, yeah. I mean, my gosh, you know. And it's interesting because he actually knew Brigham Young from the, you know, the Mormon Church. Yeah, I mean, they knew each other. I can't remember. There were so many others. I mean, that he knew in the world, and he, you know, he traveled to India, he traveled to China, he lived extensively in Ireland. He was born in Vermont, but quite a remarkable man. He had quite a life.
Well, I mean, I'm sure he's already knocking on your door to come through. So, can we start our session and see what Dr. Peebles has to say?
Yeah, absolutely. And I just
thank
go
you.
Have a great time. God bless you, Dr. Peebles. Here it is a joy and a blessing when man and spirit join together in search of the greater truths and awareness. God bless you indeed, my dear friends, as you strive to understand your right to receive and to give abundance in this your chosen lifetime. We would like to offer to you the following principles to be used as tools in tandem. Number one, loving allowance for all things to be in their own time and place, starting for yourselves. God bless you indeed. Number two, increased communication with all of life and with respect. God bless you indeed. Number three, self-responsibility for your life is a creative adventure, for through your choices and perceptions, you do indeed create your own reality. God bless you indeed, my dear friends. You have come to this school called Planet Earth to discover and dissolve the illusions of separation within self and between life. Certainly, it is your labor of love to diminish these very same illusions, wherein you will discover that never in your eternal soul have you been the victim, but always the creator. And God bless you indeed, my dear friend Alex. You're a beautiful spirit, a student of the divine. We love you so very much. My goodness gracious, you really need to talk more, though, my dear friend, because you've got so much to share from your heart, and we love you so very much. Your perspectives are fantastic. Don't ever hold yourself back. God bless you indeed. You, my dear friend, you have come to the school called Planet Earth with tremendous courage, and it was very hard for you to come back this time. You said, I don't know if I want to do it again, but if I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it right, and I'm going to have the courage to speak to the world, to share with the world from my heart, and I'm going to be seen and heard and felt by the world, because you too, my dear friend, have been persecuted in the past, in previous lifetimes, wherein you spoke so loudly from your, shall we say, soapbox, that people really looked at you and said, well, you have no right to be telling us these things. And you said, yes, I do, because I'm a human being, and I have thoughts, and I have feelings, and I have experiences and awarenesses. So what you're doing in this lifetime is you're resurrecting some of this inside of yourself, coming back to the mystic that you are. And that is part of your journey, my dear friend. You will discover the mystic that you are on a much deeper level than you ever have before. It's going to happen here in the year of 2024, and it's going to be moving on from there. God bless you indeed. As you open yourself up to receiving the light, love, inspiration, and truth, God bless you indeed. That is there for one and all. And certainly, my dear friend, we love you so very much. And would you understand? And would you have questions or comments? God bless you indeed.
Thank you so much for that. I appreciate it. My first question is, what do souls do between lives on the other side?
Gracious, so many things. It would be sometimes they just like to rest. Sometimes they come over here and they say, I want to go back. That was so much fun. And then we say, well, since you want to go back so quickly and you thought it was so much fun, you're finished. You don't have to reincarnate ever again. God bless you indeed. And certainly, my dear friend, there are so many different, it would depend upon the realm in which you are talking about. Some human beings, when they leave their bodies here, they go into a place called the astral plane because they don't believe in anything. They don't believe that there is life after death, and yet they are out of body and they wander around and they think, well, goodness gracious, why isn't anybody talking to me? And they find themselves rather confused by that experience. And this would, if you will, in some of your haunted houses and such, the spirits who live in these homes think that they are the ones who live there. They don't realize that they are the ones who are out of body. They think the others around them are the spirits, the ghosts and such. So they get very scared sometimes. And in other situations, shall we say, spirits might leave and come over here, for example, to become educated in certain things. Let's say, for example, someone wants to become a concert pianist in their next lifetime, but they don't want to go through all the process of having to learn everything when they're in the human form. So they come over here and they practice piano. Believe it or not, they can, and they do, and they learn it very, very well, and then they incarnate, and that would be your, shall we say, child prodigies and such. God bless you indeed. So there, it depends on the individual, of course. What is there? Some love to come over here and go travel to other planets, and some say, I'm never going back to that wretched place, that planet Earth, and we will always encourage you to return. But they say, no, I'm going to go travel to other planets, and they do, and eventually come back and say, well, you know something? I'm going to have to go back to that school called Planet Earth so that I can graduate into the greater, deeper understanding of myself as the God light that I am. God bless you indeed. And that, my dear friend, is the tip of the iceberg. But would you understand? And does that help? God bless you indeed, yeah?
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. My next question is, how do people overcome addiction in this life?
Ah, goodness gracious. Well, sometimes the best way to overcome addiction is to surrender into it. And then you finally really realize that you can release it. It's the constant struggling against addictions, whether it is to food, drugs, alcohol, whatever it might be that you feel you are addicted to. It could be addicted to too many kitty cats or something like that. God bless you indeed. But you overcome it by surrendering into it so that you really can deeply understand it. Some people are, for example, addicted to such things as misery. Some are addicted to such things as anger. And the more they would surrender into it, they would realize how it's time for them to release it. They would understand why they have it and then be able to release it entirely. And also forgiveness is very important. Forgiveness of self, not seeing that you're a bad person if you have an addiction to anything, because it's just part of your journey. It's a part of your learning about yourself and understanding yourself. It's society that puts the, shall we say, the labels upon individuals who are addicted to anything and feel that they must be fixed and corrected and such. Well, my dear friends, you'd do much better if somebody's smoking cigarettes to buy them boxes and boxes of cigarettes so they can see how many they're smoking in a year. And suddenly they look at it and say, my goodness, I have to smoke all of those. I don't want to smoke those cigarettes anymore. And they would walk away from it. God bless you indeed. So it's really a matter of truly loving self and learning to love self through these situations. It is an unfortunate state of affairs, of course, when you are seeing people who are in deep, deep pain and such. But at the very same time, love is always going to be the greatest healer. And it has to come within yourself first. So that some of these individuals just cannot, if you will, find that self-love until they at long last return to the earth, maybe several times with the same addiction over and over again, and finally realize, well, that's getting boring. And then they move on from there. So everybody's always going to grow. Everybody's eventually going to live happily ever after. God bless you indeed. And does that help, my dear friend? Yeah?
It does. It does. My next question is that it seems that the other side is full of infinite knowledge. So why do we have to come here to learn simple truths?
Well, human beings are very different in this respect. You're living on one of the toughest schools in the universe. It really is. And where you're learning about the illusions of separation within yourself and between life. Now, how did you get here in the first place? You fell away. You had a moment there where you thought, well, you know, something I don't know about this love and what that's all about and such. And maybe it's unnecessary, etc. And suddenly sank into, if you will, a lot of doubt. A doubt about God, about the universe and such. And it was encouraged that you would come to the school called Planet Earth, where you can at long last really see, hear, taste, touch, feel, and smell everything that is you, because that's the greater truth, that everything that you see, hear, taste, touch, feel, and smell is you. You are part of all of it. You are not separate from anything. And eventually you will come to learn this. God bless you indeed. So, and it's truly up to you as an individual to come to this awareness, to do the learning, do the education. We can't, for example, move you around like chess pieces on a board. We can't make you think or believe anything and such. You just sort of fell away. It's just another learning, and it's an education that is quite extraordinary in the universe. There's not any place quite like this planet Earth here. It is, as we say, the toughest school in the universe. So give yourself at least a pat on the back for coming here in the first place. And but if you really start to study that you are everything that you see, hear, taste, touch, feel, and smell, there is no separation, you will come to understand the energetics of the universe and beyond. And you will find freedom and flight of soul beyond your wildest dreams and imaginations. So that's a synopsis to the greater answer to the question because of time limitations here. But certainly it's a wonderful question. Thank you so very much, Alex. You're a beautiful spirit, yeah?
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for that. We understand the purpose, at least I understand the purpose of a soul being born into a poor or difficult scenario for learning purposes. But why would someone or why would a soul be born into a wealthy or easier, quote unquote, easier life? What would they learn?
That's a very good question. It really is, yeah. Well, there's a wide variety of reasons why individuals incarnate into various scenarios, but and so we would really have to take it case by case basis here in terms of somebody who's born into wealth and such. Sometimes it's really just so that they can kick the habit. They don't want it anymore. They see it's a waste of time and energy, and they start to realize what really matters. It shows them the greater truth, that the love that they carry within their family, the nurturing there, the time spent with family and friends and animals and nature and such, that these are the things that are much more important than worrying about big houses and the struggles of having to maintain money. You start to have possessions, for example, they might learn that possessions that they have start to possess them, and they have to drag all that stuff around with them every time they move to from one mansion to the next or something like that, you see. And sometimes individuals are born into those experiences so that they can give all the money away to somebody else or what have you. They want to amass money so that they can give it all away. There are plenty of people that are not spoken of upon the earth who really do this on a regular basis. They make a lot of money, they store it away, perhaps leave it to someone when they die, live like a pauper, you don't even see it. So there's again, as we say, there's lots and lots of scenarios there that you could we could share, but those are a couple of that we would share right off the bat here. God bless you indeed for your understanding. Does that help, my dear friend? Yeah,
it does help. Thank you for that. What can we do to stop greed that could end our civilization?
Yeah, well, you got to stop it inside of yourself. That's really all you can do, you see. It's got to happen within each and every person. And that, of course, would be rather ideal, wouldn't it? Yeah. But you can't make anybody stop being greedy and such. But it would take really true in truth, my dear friend, for each individual who doesn't want to have greed in the world to not be greedy themselves. And so you might even look deep inside of yourself. Is there any area of your life in which you are a bit greedy, and perhaps resolve it there first? You see, and that makes a difference in terms of the energetics of the planet Earth. You can educate people by, if you will, rewarding people who are not greedy with lots of love and for perhaps even with a lot of the stuff they think they want, such as money and such. You see, it's quite remarkable. Just as a little aside here, in terms of your planet Earth, a lot of your heads of countries and such, lots of, if you will, that politicians and others who might be very, very greedy and wanting to amass power and wanting to amass money and wanting to control everybody and such, they don't really understand that what would make them the most powerful on the planet Earth would be to give so much to others, and to help and to assist and to uplift the people in their country and such, and really take care of them and joyfully and speak honestly and truthfully and such. Oh my goodness, you know what would happen in that case? Everybody would be applauding them, loving them, hugging them, kissing them, throwing money at them. They'd have more money, more wealth, more of everything that they say they want, if they would just turn it around a little bit and do it in a different way and approach it in a different way and such. Yeah, God bless you indeed. And does that help, my dear friend?
It does. I've heard of this concept that there is no past lives, there is no future lives, that all lives are happening at the same time, and the life that we are currently, quote unquote, currently living in affects our past lives, quote unquote, and our future lives, quote unquote. So it's all happening at the same time. Can you explain that to me in a way that our small little brains can understand?
Yeah, more than likely not, but we'll attempt here. Yeah, in truth, my dear friend, everything is happening at once. You can't think of anything without it first and foremost, without it existing somewhere. And that's why you sometimes see that someone might have an idea for an invention or something like that, and they bring it forth. They first think of it, they machinate about it inside of themselves, and then they bring it and manifest it into the world. So it's already created somewhere. It's already there. And that's why you might be seeing something on television saying, wait a minute, that's my idea. They stole it. I was thinking of the very same thing, because it exists and it was ready to be birthed, and somebody ran with it, you see, and birthed it and such. So in that respect, my dear friend, the past, present, and the future is happening right here and now. Everything exists right here and now. Let's see. Right here, oh, there it goes. Now it's future, past, present, and future. You can't help it. It's all happening at once. And so there are, if you will, It's not easy for the human mind to comprehend, but if you really understand it, you'll start to come to the awareness that everything that you have ever done in your lifetime, every thought you've ever had, everything you've ever done, every kiss you've ever given, every word you've ever spoken and such, it all adds up to this right here and now. For example, for you, Alex, everything you've done in your life adds up to this moment right here and now, talking to an old spook, you see. God bless you indeed. It's all happening at once. And so, of course, this moment here that you're experiencing with yours truly here talking, is this affecting your past in some ways? Yes, it really is. Is it evolving from your past? Yes, it is. Of course it is, because that's you're here because of that, because of the things you've done in the past. And you think about, well, some of the things Dr. Peebles is telling me, I wish I'd known that when I was 7 years old. Perhaps I could have applied that more. And you think about ways in which you could have, and suddenly you've changed that part of yourself. So that's perhaps the best way we can explain it to you. Also, remember the future is there, but it's what you decide. It's what you imagine. For example, the imagination is a tremendously powerful thing that is often poo-pooed. For example, when you're a child, mommy, I don't know what to do. Oh, use your imagination. Oh, mommy, I saw my dead uncle in the hallway. Oh, goodness gracious, that's just your imagination. So you're always given these, if you will, opposites here. And so you think, well, the imagination is pointless, except for certain things, except for let's pretend or daydreaming or what have you. But the imagination is the playground for spirit. It's the imagination is a powerful, powerful thing that you have. If you visualize your future and really feel it within your body, it's all energetics. And you see it, you visualize it, you hold that thought, and you live it inside of yourself, and you feel it. What would be the experience of it? Oh, so happy, so lovely, so beautiful. I feel so wonderful. I feel so abundant, etc. And then you get up and you step into that picture, and you can manifest it very, very things very rapidly once you get the hang of it, really, ultimately. So you can, but you can also be thinking about the future in a very sad, desperate way. Nothing's ever going to manifest the way I like it. It's just going to be horrible. Well, that's wonderful, because you just created that reality, and you go ahead and step into it, and you have your learnings there. So it's yes, it's all happening at once. Lots of timelines, lots of ways in which you can move about. You are born upon this planet Earth. Is there a predestination in some respects? Yes, the destination for everybody is love, returning into the understanding of the God light that you are, and returning to the understanding that the love that you are seeking and expressing and everything else is what you are made of. And that's where you step into your enlightenment. But you come to the school called Planet Earth, and you say, well, I'm going to make a decision. I'm going to, shall we say, end up living in Greece or something like that. But you can take a wide variety of paths to living in Greece. You can go via you can fly there directly, or you can go there via all the states in the United States before you get there. Lots of ways in which you can get your final destination, which is love. And then when you understand this, what are you going to do next, you see? Once you're enlightened, what are you going to do next, yeah? God bless you indeed. The learning never ends. And does that help, my dear friend?
It does. It does. You mentioned about manifestation and manifesting your life. If we do have control of the lives that we create for ourselves, how can we explain aging? And why don't we not create a life that is endless for ourselves?
Why would you want to, really? Truly, my dear friend, you see, because if you were to live on this school called Planet Earth forever, eventually you would have learned everything that there is to learn about the planet Earth, about people in many respects, not in all ways, of course, because there's always going to be new interactions and such. But immortality would be really almost like a death sentence in itself, because it would be very quite limiting, really. So the reason you age here, and you can run away from aging all you want, but the reason you age is because you're starting to get ready to leave the Earth. You're dropping the coat of this human form. You're not your body, you see. And of course, a lot of the things that you manifest in your physical body in terms of diseases, illnesses, aches and pains and such as this, that comes about not because the body is trying to attack you. It doesn't want to do that. It wants to be loved by you. It wants and it wants to do its very best job for you. But in truth, it is your spirit that is, if you will, controlling the body in some respects. It's your spirit that is saying, ah, goodness gracious, you know something, those people over there, they gall me all the time. I don't like those people. They gall me. And all of a sudden you develop issues with your gallbladder because everything's galling you and such. Or you don't feel supported and suddenly your back is aching. You don't feel supported by the world. Nobody helps me. I have to to do it all by myself. And then you start to manifest these things in your body physically. And so you are in charge of your body. Your body's not trying to attack you either. So God bless you indeed. That was a little bit more than what you were asking, but we enjoy sharing, of course. You can tell we enjoy our conversations here, yeah? God bless you.
Now, what do you see as the future of humanity in this great shift in consciousness in this next year and beyond?
Well, you know something, it's really a fascinating time for you to be on the earth. It is a tilling of the soil, so to speak. It's the tilling of the soil that reveals all the creepy crawlers of the earth. And because of your internet and the connectedness in so many ways in your world through your devices and such, no one can get away with anything anymore. You're being exposed here for who you really are in many respects. And in some ways, not so much, because of course there's a lot of manipulation of these devices and lots of manipulation of audio and video and other things and such. But you're starting to be revealed to the world. People are starting to speak out unabashedly and exposing themselves. So it's an interesting time to be on the earth. And what's going to happen, there's a lot of contentious energy, of course. People are arguing and fighting, and there will be small civil wars around the world and such that will come up that have already happened. Lots of more earth changes and things that will be occurring simply because of the energy of the planet Earth, of you human beings. You are creating this reality for yourselves. But eventually you're going to find that the fighting and the contentious behaviors and such will become very boring to you, very boring, and old news and a waste of time. And people will start coming together collectively and realizing how very powerful you can be when you come together and find unity in your diversity, rather than seeing it as, oh, I've got to change everybody to comply and be like me. You can just dance together. You can enjoy the dance, the journey to the heart together, and find that everybody has something to contribute. And there will be a lot more, if you will, eventually. It's not going to happen right away, but you will start to see inklings of it in this year and in the next 3-4 years of human beings who are going to start saying, you know, something, we really do need to listen to each other. We need each other, and we need the differences, and we need to share. And you're going to start to realize that the thing that you do share that is in common is at the core of every single solitary human being upon this school called planet Earth, even the worst person that you can think of. At their very core, the real truth of who they are is love. And that is it. They just don't remember. They haven't found it yet. They don't understand it yet. But eventually, you're also going to find that human beings are going to realize the energetic construction of the universe. Quantum physics that human beings discuss, you will begin to understand how, if you will, massive that is in terms of deepening your understanding of your own personal power. Human beings think they are so limited, but you are not. You are not at all in any way, shape, or form. Are you limited? It is only the limitations you place upon yourselves, believing that you can't do certain things, can't walk on water, can't walk through walls, you see. But you can. You're composed of energy. And eventually human beings are going to come back to that awareness. There will be more, if you will, interactions with spirits coming to planet Earth and being revealed in a more tangible way, shall we say, as your vibration of the Earth is raised and elevated into a place where you will be more capable of seeing spirits and such. There will be more interactions in terms of UFOs and extraterrestrials because of, again, the matching of the frequencies of the energy of the planet Earth as it is elevated and raised up. Believe it or not, as difficult as it is on your Earth right now, you are coming into the fifth dimension of the greater understanding of love. It is an expansion of love. Love does not ever, ever end, my dear friend. It's ever expansive, and it is extraordinarily powerful. It is the core of everything in the universe. And even where I exist, for example, we are still exploring love. There's even deeper love to explore. Believe it or not, it is without end. It's quite extraordinary. It really is. God bless you indeed. And again, the tip of the iceberg. But does that help, my dear friend?
It does. It does. My next question is, since we live forever, where is our beginning as souls? How are new souls created?
Generated as energy from stars, sort of. If you were to visualize, if you've ever seen, for example, any photograph of the nervous system and the firing of the nerve synapses and such, you would look like that when you are born. You are a spark. that comes forth and begins to grow and says, ah, so you'll never really have been separate from any of it, but you are birthed from it. It's quite extraordinary. You're birthed from the energy of the universe of which you've been a part, but now you're the birthing part of it is coming to life. It's in a new experience of yourself. And suddenly you're perhaps flying around the universe saying, my goodness, I feel amazing. This is incredible. And you get a sense of yourself. You get a sense of your being. Human beings tend to think that in the afterlife, a lot of people think, for example, that they'll just be floating out there as a spirit and in a black wasteland or something like that, or in heaven playing harps and things like that, or a variety of things. But the reality is you are energy, but spirits do have a strong sense of themselves. We all do, just as every cell in your body has a strong sense of itself as a being, it has its own perspective of life itself. God bless you indeed. So it's quite extraordinary, though. Yeah, it's a wonderful question. And we'll say to you, Alex, that the learning never ends even for us. And so there is more to explore about the questions and the answers. Where does the universe begin and end? From what we have learned here, where I exist, it doesn't. And that's just incredibly difficult for the human consciousness to understand. There is no end to it. It's remarkable, isn't it? If human beings would just realize and contemplate just that one point for 5 minutes, their whole life would change, really, because they would start to see how great they are, how great thou art. You are beautiful spirits, and you would come to the awareness that life is eternal and that you can love each other forever. And that's the greatest dance of all. And do all sorts of things while still loving each other, yeah? God bless you. Yeah.
You mentioned before that we put limitations on ourselves of like not being able to walk through walls or do things like that. That triggered an idea inside of me, which is are the ascended masters, the masters who found enlightenment on earth, the Buddhas, the Jesus, the Yoganandas, the Babaji's, and so on. Is this a good example of beings who have now transcended the human experience to the point where they can almost play with the code of the computer simulation that we're all in, if you will?
Yeah, well, you know something, first and foremost, they found it within themselves. They didn't find it on the earth. They found it inside of themselves, you see. Mm-hmm. That's where the power begins. That's where it is. You can't, my dear friend, you cannot pick up a pencil without it first happening inside of you. You think of it, I need to pick up that pencil, and then you manifest it in the external world. But it's all happening inside of you. Everything is contained within you. Everything. Jesus Christ, Buddha, every soul that has ever walked the earth is contained within you. It's all within you, not separate from. And so these individuals that you call here ascended masters are just simply, if you will, aware of themselves, of who they really are. And they came to the earth to express themselves, to help, to assist, to uplift, and all the rest. Jesus Christ came to the earth to say, hey, let me show you here. You are not your body. And didn't run away from destiny, but ran straight into it. And with the cross and everything else. And the body was stripped away. And what was left was the beautiful spirit that he was and is forevermore. And he wanted everybody to understand this, the love that you are, how great thou art. And to let go of all of these other things that you think are so important in terms of the battles and such that you rage against one another and such, anything that is less than love. But God bless you indeed. Did that answer your question, my dear friend?
It did. And finally, do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Parting messages for the audience. You are beautiful spirits, students of the divine, and we love you so very much. Take heart, my dear friends. It's a beautiful life. It really is. It's happening all inside of you. And as you go forth in your days, please understand that it's not for you to fix everybody in the world. You can feel compassion. You can feel care. You can feel concern about things that are happening in the world. That's all right. But at the very same time, ask yourself the question, is there something I can do about it here and now? And if not, then go your way in peace, love, and harmony, and do something fun with your day. It's all right for you to be happy when others are sad. It's okay for you to enjoy your life when others are not. It is really, my dear friends, this very part of yourself that you project into the world, which is necessary for the planet Earth. You think joy and loving one another and playing and dancing and singing is not necessary. Well, my dear friends, it really is, because it keeps the light shining brightly. Become like the lighthouse and guide others safely to the shore of love by being, if you will, the most beautiful loving spirit that you can be, starting with yourself. Remember to love you. Take charge of that. Remember that you are a beautiful spirit. You are perfectly formed. God bless you indeed. You are nothing wrong with you whatsoever. Look inside of yourself and let yourself be seen and heard and felt by the world. Don't despair. Know that, my dear friends, there is a point and a purpose to all of this. You may not know it in this lifetime, but eventually you will come over to where we are. Take a look back and say, ah, now I get it. Now I realize what it was all about. God bless you indeed. It was a journey to the heart, a journey of expansion, of understanding the God light that I am. And God bless you indeed. You are a beautiful spirit, students of the divine. We love you so very much. And go your way in peace, love, and harmony, for life is indeed a joy. And all you have to do is you enjoy the journey to your own heart and certainly to your own enlightenment. You simply lighten up just a little bit more. God bless you indeed. Oh, God. Hi.
And she's back. How are you doing?
I'm okay.
Did you remember any of it?
I just remember the intensity of it. It's very physically, it's hard work physically, tugging and the pulling. Did I remember anything? It's like little. It's like waking up from a dream, you know, where you think you're gonna remember a dream when you wake up, and it's like, yeah, kind of. Oh, I remember the nervous system or something like that.
Something, yeah.
The reason I remember that is because it was so pretty. They were showing it, and it was like so beautiful. It's like, wow.
Like, so you energize? Are you energized right now? Or are you tired right now?
Oh, I'm wiped out. No.
You get wiped out by it.
Oh yeah, I know there are channels who say that they, you know,
energized.
I'm like, yeah, no, it's a physical process, you know. It because like I say, they're connecting with my body. My body's like a low voltage wire, and that's high voltage coming through it, you know. And actually, some years ago, I think I don't know, probably about 2005, I had a near death experience and I died. Okay. And because I was working so much, I was depleted. And I was actually talking to a man who was a cardiologist from a retired cardiologist from Flagstaff, and he wanted to do some tests on me at NAU to find out how the channeling was affecting my body because it was so intense. And then I had this near-death experience, and I talked to him about it the next day. I said, I don't know what happened. He said, more than likely you used up all your magnesium and your heart stopped. And I said, oh. And he said, yeah, he said even a bad psychic uses up more magnesium than the average person, which is really interesting. Yeah,
that's fascinating.
Yeah, apparently that was some study at one of the universities or something like that. And he was and then the weird thing was, right before we were going to do the testing, he died of a heart attack.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it was horrible. He was such a nice man. He was so sweet. And I was looking forward to working with him. He was very, very honorable, you know.
That's very interesting. I've heard from so many different channels that you got to kind of, your nervous system has to be prepped and kind of set up to be able to handle this energy. Like a Dr. Peebles doesn't just show up to anybody because you'll blow the circuit. And you got to kind of build up to it, if you will.
Yeah, when he first started coming through, and when I was much younger, and it was so intense. I mean, and this is intense, but it was even more so. And I finally got mad, and I said, you know, you have got to slow down. I mean, it felt like my heart was just going to burst, and you know, I mean, it just is. It's just intense. It's extremely intense. And I said, you've got to slow down. And so he next time came in very meek, very slow. And he comes in really slowly and he goes, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Well, so I'm going to ask you some or a few questions to ask all my guests.
Yeah.
What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
Just being authentic. Being authentic, be yourself, share who you are. Don't be afraid of it. And so many people hide themselves away and mask themselves and try to be something, you know, out in the world and try to fit the world. And you already fit. And if you can realize that, see, I live my life as Summer Bacon. I'm a trance medium. I see spirits, hear spirits. I have had extraterrestrial contact. I've had a near-death experience. I've had a lot of things. But what happens, and if people fall away from you because you share of who you really are, then hallelujah, you know, go ahead and you'll find the people of like mind and like heart. And that's a fulfilling life. You know, I have friends from all walks of life. They're not all believers in trance mediums. They're not all believers in God, but it's really, really fun.
If you had a chance to go back in time and talk to little Summer, what advice would you give her?
It's going to be okay, honey. Don't give up.
Fair enough. How do you define God?
Oh, how can I even define God? It's a feeling. It's like a big hug. If I had to define God, it's just this hug. It's just warmth.
Okay.
Just incredible, vast. It's without end. It's so much more than what they're talking about in church. It's just
fair enough.
Believable. Yeah.
What is love?
Oh, you know, undefinable, I would think. Because it takes so many different shapes. It's acceptance. I would say that acceptance and acknowledgement feels like love. When you speak of something from your heart and you're talking about something that people around you may not believe or whatever, if they acknowledge that and they say, wow, you know, thank you, Alex, that's interesting. It feels like love. It's like, oh, it's acceptance and acknowledgement and of all beings. That's what it is to me. Yeah.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
Love. That's it. I mean, that's the, you know, when I was 11 months old and I said to Spirit, okay, I'll find out what this truth thing is about once and for all. And I would say, you know, it's love. It's all perspectives, though. It really is. Mm-hmm. We keep trying to put it in a box. And I think, you know, the expression, if everything is green, then nothing is green.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You
know, we need the contrast. We need the light. We need the dark. Or we couldn't even see each other right now without both.
And where can people find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing in the world?
Summerbacon.com, summer like the season, bacon like the food. so it's www.summerbacon.com. And
do you have any parting messages for the audience?
You know, I would say the same thing to the audience as I would have said to my little self, little Summer, is don't give up. Really don't give up and be brave enough to be you, because that's enough. It really is.
Summer, it has been such a pleasure talking to you and Dr. Peebles today. I appreciate you, and I hope this conversation helps people around the world. So I appreciate you.
Thank you so much, Alex. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.